everybody. Welcome to church. My name is Duan. I'm so honored to worship with you today. If you're watching online, all of our friends at God Behind Bars, glad to have y'all as well. This is a great Sunday to be at church. As you can tell, we got Baptism Sunday today. That means people have decided to follow Jesus and make a public declaration of their faith. That's good news today. And I hope y'all had a great week. I want to invite you to stand. We're going to sing some songs together first to start our worship service. If you're at home or at God Behind Bars, come on, why don't you sing along with us? We're going to sing about the God who's been the same from the beginning of creation, the same one who sent the sun in the heavens, the same one who split the oceans, the same one who healed blinded eyes and raised people from the dead. That spirit is in the room today. If you believe in Jesus, he's in you. And I believe if you don't know him today, this is a great day to meet the Lord. And that's why we worship him. He's the same God that we worship for all generations. Are y'all ready to praise that God today? Come on, church, are you ready to praise the Lord? Come on, let's do it.
I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me.
This is our prayer today. Come on, let's sing.
Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you. How I need you. Oh, rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness.
On your faithfulness.
This morning, we believe that you have everything that we need. So we raise our faith to you. We trust you. We worship you.
You heard your children, then you hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will.
You sing.
That's right.
You were providing. You are providing.
Do y'all believe that?
You are the same God.
He's the same God.
You are the same God. Oh. You moved in power then. God moved in power.
He's the same God.
You are.
invite you to lift your hands as we sing this last verse. Let's invite him here. Come on.
I'm calling on the Holy Spirit. Oh, my. Come and fill us again. Come and fill me again.
One more time, let's sing.
Standing on your faithfulness today. Thank you that your goodness doesn't change, your faithfulness doesn't change, Lord. Like the shifting of shadows, you are the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Great is your faithfulness, Father. We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord.
Great is thy faithfulness, oh God.
God, you are mighty, and we are here to worship you. I'm just reminded even right now that you are seated on your throne, sovereign over the world, and worthy of our praise. So we take a deep breath in of our Heavenly Father, a perfect Heavenly Father who we can trust today, who holds the world in his hand, and is that big, yet knows us intimately. Knows our name, knows our story, and loves us. The one who knows us the best and loves us the most. So today we say thank you for your love. And we pray for an anything's possible kind of story over our time together. And we believe you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Man, you can have a seat. What an incredible start to the day.
So glad that you're here. I want to take a moment and welcome you on a really special Sunday. If we haven't met, I'm Darren. I get to serve as campus pastor here in Nashville. And if you're with us online, I'm grateful that you're here as well. It is Baptism Sunday, a day that we get so excited about. But before we talk about that, I want to take a moment and welcome anyone that's new to CrossPoint. Maybe you came on Easter and you're back today. Maybe you're here for the very first time, or maybe you're tuning in online for the very first time. We're so grateful that you're here, and we hope that you experience an anything's possible kind of story in this hour with us. But I want you to know how you can find some information about the church. You can text the word new to 615-615, and that would be our heart that we could come alongside you with some information about what God is doing here, because truth is, you're invited into that story and what he's doing. So I'm grateful that you're here, and it is Baptism Sunday. That is a day that we get so excited about as a church. It's a picture. It's a picture. Baptism is symbolic, that we say we believe in the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And here in just a few moments, we're going to get to witness, after a great message by Pastor Kevin, a lot of people symbolically identify with that life. And as people come out of the water, it symbolizes they have a new life, a new story, and we get to be the very first people to celebrate that with them. And so I'm so glad you're here today. And there may be some in the room that God would stir in your heart and in your life in a way today where today could even be your day, even if you didn't plan it. And listen, we have put a lot of work in so that you could do that. We have everything that you would need, from the change of clothes to a conversation to help you process that. And we'll talk about that later in the service, but I'm really expectant for what God is gonna do in our time together today. And I wanna invite our guest experience team to come forward to receive offering. And as we do, just with the heart in the posture of baptism, that's a step of faith. And I want to take that opportunity to say thank you for the way that you give so faithfully. Like, we give toward the mission. We give to help people find and follow Jesus. That's why we live generously here. And so I want to say thank you for the way that you give. If you are new, there's no pressure for you to give today. Just really grateful that you're here. But for anybody that would like to take that step, the ways you can do that are on screen in addition to the buckets that are being passed. And a great message today. We're here for week two of our series, About Time. Pastor Kevin is here with us. And before we get there, we have a pretty incredible baptism story that we get to hear together. So let's check out Dakota's story.
I grew up the daughter of a mother who had a really severe alcohol addiction. Growing up, my mom was in and out of treatment facilities and prison just due to her addictions. I had just given up on having a relationship with my mom. I had a lot of anger and resentment. My mom had gotten out of prison, and she got down on her knees in the kitchen and prayed to God to take away her addiction. She felt like she was at the point that she needed to surrender. That was the beginning of my curiosity. I was definitely not sure if my mom would stay sober, nervous about the future, but it definitely piqued my curiosity. And then in the years that followed, I saw my mom grow in her faith. About 4 years ago, is when my personal faith journey began. I was going through some personal struggles in my life, just in relationships, in my career, and I felt like I was at a low in my life. And I had seen the way that God had worked in my mom's life, and I felt like I could no longer handle these things by myself. So I was actually driving by a church from my hometown that I drove by my whole life, and I just felt a really strong, overwhelming feeling to pull into the parking lot and go into the church. I felt that I had no idea how to talk to God and how to give up my life to Him and surrender to Him. But I knew that it just had to start with a conversation. I'm struggling with so much pain and hurt, and I can't get through it myself, and I don't know how to do this on my own anymore, and I need your help. And he listened. Since then, my journey was really private. I didn't talk about it to anybody. I went to church very privately. I was just trying to figure everything out by myself. And I heard baptisms were coming up, and I felt an overwhelming urge to be baptized because I wanted to stop living a private life. I felt like, why does everybody know everything else about me? You know, everything we share on social media, everything we tell everybody, but nobody knows how much I love Jesus and how much God has saved my life and my mom's life. And so I feel like because I made that decision to take my faith public, like God is now allowing me to use my journey to help other people get closer to God. Every day, I pray for the people that are still struggling with anger and resentment. And I pray that they will surrender to Jesus Christ so that they can know the peace that he can bring them.
Dakota, we are so proud of you. And for you sharing that story with us, that is, that's what we are here for. That's why we're here, to help people find and follow Jesus. And Dakota, when you talked about your mom and you talked about what both of you have experienced, I'm like, that is a with Jesus, anything's possible kind of story. And we celebrate that today on Baptism Sunday, where there will be many who take that next step of baptism. Back on Easter, there were 177 people who put their faith and their trust in Jesus for the first time. So can we just give God glory for that and give him praise for that? And then I want to let you know that there were 6 ladies at God Behind Bars who put their faith in Jesus for the first time too. So we want to celebrate you, ladies, and the Deborah K. Johnson Rehabilitation Center, our campus, God Behind Bars. It's amazing to see what God's doing across all of Middle Tennessee and what he wants to do in your life as well. As it's Baptism Sunday, and there will be many who have already put their faith in Jesus who will go public baptism. Maybe some made that decision on Easter. Maybe some today who put their faith in Jesus for the very first time. And baptism will be the next step for you, where, like Dakota talked about, where maybe faith has been private, but today be made public. And private faith lacks power. But when you go public with your faith, there is power in that, and it encourages other people as well. And so we'll celebrate with you if that's the next step that God has for you. We're in this series called About Time. And Annie kicked off the series last week in talking about Jacob, and it's a great teaching. If you missed it, I want to encourage you to go back. She talked about the last verse in about Jacob in the scriptures. It's Hebrews chapter 11, verse 21. It says, "By faith Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons and worshiped as he leaned on the top of his staff." And Annie used that verse to help us think about what we would want other people to say about us. Like, how would we want our last sentence to read? Our summary sentence to wrap up our lives, how would we want that to read? And so she encouraged us to go ahead and work on that this week. And so what we're going to do right now, go ahead and get those out, and we're going to pass them to the right. We're going to collect. I'm just kidding. That's just, some of you just broke out in hives. It took you back to those days. It was not required homework, but it's recommended hard work. Because we realize that there will be people who spend more time preparing their taxes this year. Just heads up, it's tomorrow. There will be more people who spend their time preparing their taxes than they do preparing their purpose statement. There will be people who are more aware of when they need their next oil change than they are of what their mission in life is. And one of the reasons is because that little sticker that sits up on the windshield, right? Because they know if they keep it in front of you, it's helpful. If we keep, and we want, during this series, we're going to keep this in front of us. Our mission, our purpose, because none of us know how long we have. I mean, there are 24 hours in every day of our lives except for 2 days. The first one, the day we're born, and we celebrate that every year. But then the other is the day that we die. And none of us know when that will be. But it is a reminder when we think on that of just how precious life is. And we want our time on earth to matter. And we want it to matter for what matters most. And when we look at Jacob's story, what happens is we think about our lives. We think about the lives that we're living. And I'll just tell you, as we look at Jacob's story, if your life is all put together, you're not going to resonate with this series. If everything's always been up and to the right and you've never had any struggles, you're going to have a hard time connecting with Jacob's life. But if you've stumbled and if you've struggled and if you've got doubts and if you have frustration and if you have things in the rearview mirror that you're not real proud of, if you have regret, if you've got relationships that are broken, if you've experienced something like that in the past, well, you're going to connect with Jacob's story, especially if you've ever felt stuck. Anybody ever felt stuck? Anybody ever felt like you've wasted time? Then you're really going to resonate with Jacob's story. One of my favorite verses about time is this little verse that's tucked away in the Old Testament. It's tucked away in Joel chapter 2, verse 25. It's a promise that God gives. It's a God who loves and restores and redeems. And listen to what he says. He says, I will restore the years that the locusts have eaten. Israel is an agricultural society. And so they depended on the harvest, and what the big locusts didn't eat, the smaller locusts ate, and they had been decimated by locusts. The crops had been destroyed, and God makes them a promise. He said, I will redeem what the locusts have eaten. I will redeem the locust years. Anybody have any locust years? You look back, and maybe it was a business venture that went sideways. You feel like it's just wasted time, or maybe there was a career that you invested your life in, a relationship that's no longer together, and you have changed your status on Facebook and you've scrubbed all of their pictures from Instagram. But when you look back, you still feel like I've wasted time. Maybe it's a disease or an illness, physical illness, or an injury. You feel like I've wasted time. Maybe you didn't come to Christ until later on in life and you want to make a difference, but when you look back at how much of life was made about self, you feel like it's wasted time. And the promise God makes here is, I will redeem what the locusts have eaten. That we serve a God who redeems time. That in a moment, somebody can come into your life and it can be so good that you forget the other years. Maybe an opportunity that overnight in career changes things, one that you didn't see coming, and God redeems wasted time. He reconciles. He leads to reconcile relationships and bring healing and restoration. God can accelerate things and he can move things. We have a God who redeems time. And what we're going to see from Jacob's story is that we have a God who loves and pursues and redeems lost time. What he did for Jacob, I believe he can do for you. Because the hero of Jacob's story is not Jacob. The hero is God. But Jacob's life was offered to him, and God brought redemption. So I've been thinking a lot about time, and as I've been thinking about it, I'm a pretty driven person. I'm, you know, type A, like get things done. But I was thinking about it, I was like, I haven't always been like that. And I started to think, when did that change? And I think it changed when I had a midlife crisis at 17. And I've told some of you the story before, but you just humor me and listen to it again. It happened when I was 17 and I was senior in high school, and I got an invitation to the Scholastic Awards ceremony. It was in my mailbox, and it took me off guard because my GPA was 2.38. 2.38. Make sure you include the 8, right? We're rounding up. And so I was shocked, and I went in and told my parents, and they were proud. That they didn't know how I got invited, but we all went together as a family. We show up, and we're looking around, and one of these things is not like the others. Like, it's all the smart people that I had no classes with, and so I'm sitting there, and there the principal gets up, and all the teachers are giving away awards, and people have got tassels, and they've got pins, and they've got, you know, sashes, and they've got all these. They look like Christmas trees, and I've got nothing. And I remember sitting there, and I'm thinking, it was a mistake. And then the principal gets up, and he says, we have one last award, and this award goes to someone who we believe has potential. Someone in this room who we believe that you have more to offer than what you're currently living. Someone in this room who is not living up to your potential. And at that moment, I began to pray, God, please don't say Kevin Queen. Please don't say Kevin Queen. Please don't say Kevin Queen. And sure enough, my class of 300-something, principal, he said, this award goes to Kevin Queen. And it was the most awkward clap you'd ever experience. It was It's like, how do you clap for the underachiever award? You know, it's just people don't, you're not prepared for that moment. They didn't see it coming, and neither did I. And I remember I got up, and it was like there were cinder blocks on my feet going up to get this little book called the I Dare You Award. Basically, we dare you to do something. Just do something. So I got that book, and I read that tiny little book. First book I read, but I read that tiny little book that night, but something shifted, something changed. And I think it was being called out that I had potential, because when you're being told that you have potential, you don't want it, you want it to be on a beach somewhere with the sun setting and somebody just whisper, just you and them, hey, you've really got potential. You don't want to be in a microphone in front of all the smart people, right? That somebody would call you out like that. And I think it marked me, because really there was a sense of urgency, because I'm like, you know what? I don't want to die with potential. Like, potential is the one thing you don't want to die with. I started thinking about it, let it play out. Like, I don't want to be at a nursing home or assisted living home one day and have somebody look at me 90 years old and say, hey, Kevin, you've really got potential. Like, potential is the one thing that you don't want to die with. And so I think the healthy side of that kickstarted some things in me of, like, I want to use my potential. But I think the unhealthy side is this narrative that I began to maybe buy into, and it was this: I should be further than I am right now. And I think that began to play. Anybody else ever have that thought, I should be further than I am right now? And so this began to play, like, I should be further in character, and I should be further in family, and I should be further in career. Maybe something, I should be married by now, or I should have kids by now, or I should be further in education, or I should be further in fitness. I should be further than I am right now. I should have grandkids by now, or I should have my finances in order by now, or I should have more saved for retirement by now, or I should have purchased a house by now. And so there can be this narrative, like, I should. My friend Chip Dodd says this way. He said, Kevin, you can easily should yourself to death. And so we can should ourselves to death, and that we continue to live driven by this sense of, I should. And social media piles on the shoulds. Experts tell us, they tell us the kind of life that they say, you know what, you should wake at 3:30 a.m. and you should run 10 miles and you should lift 2 hours and you should cold plunge 45 minutes and you should eat 6 eggs and then you should read 6 books and then you should drink a gallon of water and then you should start a side hustle and you should trade crypto and you should get in the office by 9. Like, that is... And so there are a lot of shoulds out there. And this can be overwhelming to think, well, if I want to maximize, and I believe we all want to maximize, but we can bring that into faith and we can bring that into religion and think that God shoulds on us. You should do this and you should do that. Instead, we have a Heavenly Father who loves us and who woos us and who draws us and who leads us, who guides us, who commands us and who instructs us. But he doesn't say, you should be more like so-and-so and so-and-so down here. He leads us to become more like Christ and form Christ in us, but he gives us a new heart. I love how Brennan Manning says it this way. He says, God loves you unconditionally as you are and not as you should be, because nobody is as they should be. God loves you unconditionally as you are right now. And I think inside of all of us, there is a longing. I think one of the reasons that we want to maximize our potential is because we want approval. We want other people to approve of us. I believe inside of all of us, I think this is a universal thing, that you can travel around the world, different continents, and what you'll find, there's a universal longing for approval, specifically this hunger for a father's approval. John Eldridge says that it's every father's responsibility to answer a question that's in the heart of a child. He said, every little boy is asking, do I have what it takes? And every little girl is asking, am I lovely? And he says, it's the father's job in 1,000 different ways, 1,000 times to answer that question. Yes, you have what it takes. And yes, you are lovely. And so we have this question deep down inside, and some of us came from homes where that question was answered. Some of us came from homes where that question wasn't answered. And so we brought that question to the world. And what I want to tell you today and what I want you to see from the scriptures is that your Heavenly Father gives the answer to that question. Your Heavenly Father loves you, and your Heavenly Father meets you in that place and that longing of your heart with his love. And so today we're going to look at Jacob's life, and we're going to look at one of the chapters in his story, chapter 27 in Genesis 27. And I think this is one of the saddest, it's one of the saddest chapters in his story, because Jacob wanted the father's blessing, but unfortunately, he had to pretend to be somebody else to get it. Genesis chapter 27. If you'll remember last week, Jacob has a twin, and his twin's name is Esau. And in Jacob, his name means heel grabber, and Esau means hairy. So you got Jake and Harry. And these two twins, they're nothing like one another. Esau was into bucks and trucks and ducks. I mean, he was an outdoorsman. And Jacob was into spreadsheets, chinos, and a nice creme brulee. I mean, they couldn't be more different. Esau drove a Silverado, Jacob drove a Prius, and so they're just different. And the only thing that they had in common was a dysfunctional family. They had a mom and dad who played favorites, and Isaac favored Esau, and Rebekah favored Jacob. That's where we pick up in verse 1. And when Isaac was old and his eyes were so weak that he could no longer see, he called for Esau, his older son, and said to him, "My son." "Here I am," he answered. And Isaac said, "I am now an old man, and I don't know the day of my death. Now then, get your equipment, your quiver, and your bow, and go out to the open country to hunt some wild game for me. Prepare me the kind of tasty food that I like, and bring it to me to eat, so that I may give you my blessing before I die." Now, if you've got a Bible of your own, you can underline that word blessing, because it's a really big deal. I think it's hard in our culture, in our day, to wrap our minds around all of what the blessing meant, but it is more than an inheritance. It carries all kind of spiritual significance. This is transfer of power and authority and promise and success. It conveys the favor of God, and it's a really big deal to get the blessing. And Isaac is old. He can't see because he didn't put on the glasses when he looked at the eclipse, so he can't see. He should have listened to Rebecca, but she told him. But he's going blind, and he thinks he's about to die. He ends up living a lot longer than this, but he was going through some physical issues that caused him to think that he's about to die. And so he's thinking, "I got to get this blessing to Esau," and he does it in private. You know why? Because God gave a word to Rebecca that the older would serve the younger. And so Esau, what he's doing in that moment is he's going against God's will. He's going against what God wants. And anytime we go against what God wants, anytime we put our will above God's will, anytime we elevate our preferences because of what God has commanded, we get ourselves in trouble. And so Esau is going outside of the will of God. He's worked out a plan to bless Esau instead of Jacob. Now Rebecca hears about what's going on, and she's not having it. And so she comes up with a plan, and she pulls Jacob aside. She says, "Here's what I want you to do. Go get a goat. You're gonna go get a goat, and then we're gonna cook up. I'm gonna cook that up, and I'm gonna make it taste like venison, like your dad likes. And then I'm gonna do that. And I want you to go get some goat skin, and we're gonna put it on your hands, and we're gonna put it on the back of your neck, so that you'll because you don't have any, you know, you're not hairy like your brother. So I want you to go do that. And then we're gonna get Esau's clothes, and we're gonna put it on you. And then you're gonna take that meal to your father, and you're gonna get the blessing." Now imagine Jacob in that moment, putting the costume on, hair on his hands, on the back of his neck, duct tape, Elmer's glue, puts on Esau's robe so that he can smell like Esau. He's carrying this plate of food, and his heart is longing for the father's blessing, but he's afraid. He's afraid that they're going to be found out. He's afraid that he's going to be found out. And he enters into the room where his dad is. And what happens next is sad. Verse 18 says, he went to his father and said, "My father." "Yes, my son," he answered. "Who is it?" "I am Esau, your firstborn. I have done as you have told me. Please sit up and eat some of my game so that you may give me your blessing." Jacob lies. It's deception. He's pretending. He lies and the voice is off, and Isaac senses that something's not right. And he says, "Are you really Esau?" And Jacob says, "I am." This is the first biblical record of identity theft. Jacob is stealing Esau's ID for a blessing. He says, come closer. He draws near. And I was thinking about that in that moment. Maybe he draws nearer than he's ever been in his life, or at least in a long time. He draws near, and Isaac feels the hair on his hands, and he smells Esau's robe. And then he eats the food. And then his father Isaac says to him, come here, my son, and kiss me. So he went in to kiss him, and he kissed him. This is a kiss of betrayal. And when Isaac caught the smell of his clothes, he blessed him and said, ah, the smell of my son is like the smell of a field that the Lord has blessed. May God give you heaven's dew and earth's riches, an abundance of grain and new wine. May nations serve you and peoples bow down to you. Be Lord over your brothers, and may the sons of your mother bow down to you. May those who curse you be cursed, and those who bless you be blessed. And the reason that this is so sad for me is that in this moment, Jacob is hearing the words that he's longed to hear from his father. But he knows that they were words that were crafted in poetry and form. And as they flowed, his heart knew, these are Esau's words. These are words that were crafted for Esau. He gets the blessing, but he had to pretend to be somebody else. And I thought, you know what? This is not just Jacob. It's not just Jacob's story. It's all of our story, isn't it? And that we can all, we so long for the approval, and we so long to know that we matter, and we so long to be valued, that sometimes we pretend to get there. We can pretend to be further and faster and smarter and better than we are. We can pretend to be skinnier than we are. And filters on internet and in real life, you know, they may. I almost died on Easter weekend, not from preaching seven services, but from taking a picture out in the lobby with my family, because the person who was taking the picture took a really long time, and I figured out something, that I hold my breath in pictures. I didn't know it at the time, but I'm holding my breath, and I'm smiling, and I'm holding my breath. You know why? Because I'm sucking in. I'm sucking in, and so I'm holding my, that's why I hold my breath, because I'm trying to pretend like I don't have a tummy. And so in that moment, I'm pretending like I have a six pack. And I'm like, if I just hold my breath, all will be held together. My family's around me. And I realize I am getting lightheaded. This person is taking way too long, almost fell over. Listen, pretending will exhaust you. Pretending will exhaust us. And so many of us, we go through life and we're sucking in. We're trying to pretend that we are further and that we're faster and that we're better than we are. It's exhausting in relationships. It's exhausting with family. It's exhausting online. And we can wonder, man, if I do this, will I matter to you? And if I say this, will you like me? If I post this comment, man, will you approve? So we can pretend to know more and to be more and to do more. Man, if I make this team, will it matter to you? And if I join this club, will it matter to you? If I wear these clothes, will it matter to you? If I have that body, will you approve? And if I get that job, then will you like me? And then will it matter to you? And we can go through life falling into the trap of Jacob, and there is more than one way to put on Esau's clothes. It's this longing to be approved and to be valued and to be loved. Turn with me to Mark chapter 1 over in the New Testament. Mark chapter 1. I want you to see Jesus' baptism. Verse 10. I'm sorry, we'll pick up at verse 9. At that time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as Jesus was coming out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." Jesus was the only baptism that had special effects. So here we have the dove descending on him, and then we have the Father's voice said, "This is my beloved son with whom I'm well pleased. This is my boy. I'm proud of you." Now, what had Jesus done before this moment? I mean, from a worldly sense, like, he didn't have a LinkedIn yet, okay? When Jesus, in this moment, what had Jesus done? For 30 years, he had been the son of a carpenter. He had been an apprentice in a carpentry shop. There had been no great sermons. He hadn't called any disciples. There had been no great ministry, no signs, wonders, no miracles. He had lived in obscurity in Nazareth for 30 years. And the Father says, "This is my beloved Son with whom I'm well pleased." Before Jesus did anything of significance in ministry, he received the Father's blessing. Why did the Father give him his blessing? Because Jesus needed to hear it. Fully God, fully man, he needed to hear it. He needed to know it. And God gave his approval and his blessing before the ministry of Jesus, before his ministry began. He gives the hug before Jesus takes the field. Kids in athletics, like Rhea and I, we always want to give the hug before they take the field. Because there's a big difference in playing from the father's hug or the mother's hug instead of playing for their hug. And so many of us in life, we live for the approval of others and for the blessing, and we're trying to think, I have to perform to get the blessing. But what this shows us is that Jesus receives the blessing before his ministry began. And God's desire is that we would live from his love, not for his love, because we can't earn what's already been given, but that we receive and live from that. And God loves you as you are right now. As you are right now. He loves you unconditionally. And he changes us and he transforms us, but he woos us and he draws us and he calls us to follow him. And so how does this apply to our lives? Well, we don't live for the hug, we live from the hug. Let me show you how this works. So on Monday morning, when you walk into a meeting and you feel a little insecure, and this is why it's important for us to start our day with God, so we're reminded of who we are and whose we are and what we're called to do. So we live our lives from the love of God, from who we are in him. But you can be reminded before you walk into that meeting that regardless of what happens in the meeting, you already have the Father's love, that you already have the Father's blessing, that we already have. So you allow his love to fill any insecurity that we have. When you're having a conversation with somebody over lunch and they're like, "Hey, do you know so-and-so?" And you're like, and you're tempted because you don't know so-and-so, but you're tempted to go, "Oh yeah, I know so-and-so," because you don't want them to think that you don't know so-and-so. Don't look at me like that. I mean, there's like, yeah, well, me too. Like there's those moments and where I'm tempted to go, okay, I can just say, "Yeah, I know so-and-so," to pretend in those moments. But then I remember, you know what? My value is not in my network. My value is in who I am to the Father. I've already received the Father's blessing. So I can go, "No, I don't know so-and-so." And they're like, "Oh, okay, you should meet so-and-so." I'm like, don't shoot on me. So there's like, in that, it changes, it transforms. When you feel tempted to buy that status symbol, whichever one came to mind just then, that status symbol, the thing that we can't afford or the thing that we don't need, but if I just have that, then other people will think. And that moment, we're like, "I don't need that." Because my status doesn't come from the things that I have. My status comes from who has me. And that I already have the Father's blessing. This transforms the way that we live. It transforms the way that we relate with others. It transforms the way that we use our money. Now, let me show you something from Galatians chapter 3, verse 26. It says, "So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." Here's what this means. You are in Christ. You are in Christ, and what he tells us here is that you have been baptized into Christ, literally been immersed into Christ, and he said you have been clothed in Christ. The moment you put your faith and trust in Jesus, there was this great exchange that took place in that he took your sin, your guilt, your shame, your crimes, all placed on him on the cross, and you received the righteousness of God. Now here, this is the good news, is that in that moment, you receiving Christ's righteousness, now when God looks at you, he doesn't see your sin, he sees his son. And God loves you as much as he loves his son. The very same love that the Father loves the Son with, he loves you with. You didn't earn it. We don't deserve it. A price was paid for us. Jesus laid his life down the cross so that we could receive the righteousness of Christ. You have been clothed in the righteousness of Christ. So baptism is a picture of that Father's blessing, in that just when Jesus was baptized, the Father said, "This, you are my beloved Son, with whom I'm well pleased." You need to know that's what the Father says over you the moment you put your trust in Jesus Christ. So baptism is the blessing. Baptism is a picture of that blessing, of receiving the Father's blessing. So if you've never experienced that, maybe you put your faith in Jesus, you have received salvation. Baptism is letting everybody know, I've trusted Jesus. I've put my trust in him. And the moment you put your trust in Jesus, your older brother, Jesus, he puts his robe on you. You don't have to steal it. You can't steal it. He puts his robe. He said, I've paid the price for this. He puts his robe on you, his righteousness. And now you smell like the aroma of Christ. The aroma of Christ. And the Father said, that's my beloved son. That's what he says to you. You are my beloved son. He says, you are my beloved daughter. With you I am well pleased, which answers the longing of our heart. Do I have what it takes? Or am I lovely that you have the Father's love? And so this is why he says, you are children. And the Spirit of God and the Spirit inside of you cries out, Abba, Father. That through Christ, we can know the Father in that way. And that's what we get to celebrate on Baptism Sunday. And so our first baptism is just the picture of this that we get to celebrate together, is that you don't have to get your life put together before we come to baptism. You don't clean up your life before you're baptized. You come to Jesus and he cleans up your life. You don't take a bath before you take a shower. You come to Jesus and he cleans up your life. There is a transformation, and you don't have to pretend. Just bring the real you. Bring the realest you. That's the one God wants, because he can't bless somebody you're pretending to be. So you bring the real you to a real God, and he meets you with his love. That's the invitation today, to receive that love and that grace. And that's what we see in Matthew's story. Our first baptism of the day is Matthew's story. I'll share his story with you, and then we'll celebrate his baptism together. These are his words. He said, I grew up going to church on Easter and Christmas Eve and never was really involved in the church. Going into high school, I had a friend bring me to church, but after some bad experiences with people there, I wrote off Christianity for a long time. I made the mistake of judging the Savior off the people who followed him and slipped into an atheist mindset, battling anxiety and depression, as well as a drug problem in college, and putting me at the lowest time in my life. In my early 20s, I wanted to change from a dark place, so I started to try to fix my life on my own, but nothing really seemed to work. I finally started with prayer, asking God to be my Savior and help me out of the personal hell that I was in. Since then, I've been drug-free, in the best shape of my life, and gone to therapy to work through past trauma and so much more, all because I gave my life to Christ. Through him, I found salvation, and I have been called to baptism for some time now, and today I take that step. Let's celebrate that step together.
Man, I just want to say thank you for going first and having the courage. Our prayer is that for a lot of people, they would hear a story like that and know that they can have a story like that too. And that's why, as a church, we say anything's possible. And so, man, I'm thankful for you, what God's doing in your life. And I want to ask you two questions. Do you believe in Jesus for the forgiveness of your sin?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And you want to follow him the rest of your life?
I do.
Yeah. Well, then that's a privilege for me to get to baptize you as a brother. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Come on, bro.
Today we celebrate Matthew's story. And the scripture tells us that even when one person returns, repents, comes back home to the Father, that all of heaven breaks out in a party. It's going to be a celebration and a party today. And maybe your story is similar to Matthew's story, and that you need to go public with your faith. Maybe a faith that you've had for a while, but to put your faith in him. There may be some today that right now is the moment where you have that great exchange, where you receive God's grace and forgiveness for the first time. So I want to invite you to bow your heads and your hearts with me. I want to lead you in a prayer. And for those who would say today, I need that exchange. I trust in what Jesus did on the cross for my sin, that he died for me. I want to live for him. I want to lead you in a simple prayer. You can just pray it in your own words, or you can whisper it after me. If that's you, Father, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending Jesus to die on the cross for me. And I believe that he is raised from the dead. And right now, I give my life to you. All of me. For all of you. I turn from my sin, and I turn to you. So I receive your righteousness. I want to live for you here on earth and live with you forever in heaven. Thank you for saving me. Father, I pray for those who made that their prayer. Would you give them the courage and the boldness to tell somebody, or to even go public with their faith today in baptism? And then God, as a church, would up there come down here in our celebration and our rejoicing of how you bring about new life and how with Jesus anything's possible. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
And now we get to celebrate what God is doing. Can we one more time for Matthew just start with a heart of celebration? It's one story at a time that we get to respond. I want to invite you to stand to your feet. And for many, it is likely that God is stirring in your heart that even now you would ask, maybe today could be my day. Listen, our team is prepared to get to serve you in a conversation. So located at each exit door, our guest experience team wearing everyone's welcome shirts would love to lead you through a conversation about if this is the right step for you. And if it is, we have everything that you would need. We would love nothing more than to get to serve you in that way. And then for the rest of us, this is a moment to remember the love that God has for you and to affirm and to celebrate what he's doing in the life of our church. And let's receive these next few moments together in worship. Let's do that.
His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 Amen.
And your children, and your children, and your children.
church, can we just as one big choir celebrate what God's doing in our in and amongst us? Like, we start with Matt's story, but it's one story at a time that anything is possible. And I would say in this moment, there is still water in the tub. I believe there could be people in the room even now that God is stirring in your heart. Today could be your day. I don't know if you know this, but we do another service after this. There's still water in the tub. Today can be the day for you. I want to say thank you for being here. And each story, one story at a time, is a picture of what it looks like to live a new story. And that's what God has for us as a church. Hope you have a fantastic week. Can't wait to see you back next Sunday.